Dana, Georgia, Gloria, Maybelline, and Helen. Do any of those names sound like any type of like familiar, like in the context of like Texas State to you?
No.
If I'm correct, those are the women who integrated Texas State. I don't remember what year that was.
I think that those are the five women who integrated Texas State, so.
Dana, Georgia, Gloria, Maybelline, and Helen. Those are the names of the five women who became the first black students to attend Southwest Texas State College in 1963 after the federal district court in Austin, Texas ordered that the school be desegregated. Since then, what is now known as Texas State University has changed so much. It would actually take me another 57 years to break down that history for you. So instead, I'll tell it through three of its organizations: the Texas State Strutters, the University Star, and Student Government. Starting with the Strutters, you can't read anything about them without the mention of Mrs. Barbara Tidwell, who founded the organization in 1960. In fact, they were the first dance team organized on any major university campus in the state of Texas. They performed at presidential inaugurations. They were the first U.S. dance team to perform in the People's Republic of China. You may have even seen them in the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. The Strutters have done it big. Now let's break down the University Star. Its slogan is, defending the First Amendment since 1911. So yeah, they've been around forever. But the one thing everyone loves to mention is the fact that former U.S. President and Texas State alumnus Lyndon Baines Johnson served as the paper's editor-in-chief during the summers of 1928 and 29. But most importantly, they've worked to provide quality journalism to the Texas State and San Marcos community for over a century. And now it's time for Student Government. If it has something to do with your student service fee, Student Government knows about it. It once had a president by the name of Bill Wright, who served as a friend and assistant to President LBJ, who we just mentioned. Its interests involved representing the student interests and concerns to the Texas State Administration. Oh, and we can't forget to mention a gentleman by the name of Connor Clegg. But nonetheless, all of those historic organizations have served as the faces of Texas State student leadership. Years upon years of leadership. Years upon years of white leadership. But only until the first blacks arrived.
Being the first black head captain of the Texas State Strutters is legendary.
Being the first black editor of the Star was a trip. That's what I'm gonna leave it at.
Being the first black student president is an honor and a privilege.
I came from an elementary school, middle school, and high school that was predominantly black.
I didn't come from a whole lot of money. I'm a first generation student.
At 9 years old, I went into foster care.
I never understood, you know, what it was like to be black in a different type of setting, which is the setting that's most common in society. But I never knew that because I grew around people that look like me. So it was kind of a little bit of a shock when I got here. I was like, well, like, I'm different than everybody else. But I kind of thought when I first got here my freshman year that I was going to have to pretend to be someone I wasn't.
When it comes to being a black student at Texas State, there are obviously the challenges of imposter syndrome. And then particularly in the time that I was here in these 4 years, we've, this is right at 2016, where you have the election of Donald Trump. Political tensions are at a high, racial tensions are at a high. You have outsiders to the campus coming in to, you know, do everything they can to make sure, because even when we talk about it, imposter syndrome, right, like, or feeling like you don't belong in a place, like, that doesn't just happen.
I think it's very important for folks like me, who look like me, to succeed in places like this. When we're talking about predominantly white institutions that were not built for us and do not provide us the essential support that we need to excel, It's important for us to do well. And so when I walk campus, and a lot of times, and I'm the only person, you know, there's not a lot of people that are looking like me or who share some of the same things that I share. I think it can be difficult.
Some challenges that I face being here is having just peers, classmates, friends that, you know, may make comments that can be discriminatory or be considered racist. But I have a strong belief that everybody who's racist doesn't always know they're racist, or they may make comments they don't realize is kind of embedded in them from past racism. So that's kind of been the biggest, you know, thing for me, is trying to explain it to people, like, okay, you may not have meant this, but that's where it comes from. You don't even realize it's where it comes from. And also trying not to offend people by letting them know, by educating people, you can't offend them because they think you're calling them racist.
On one hand, you know, you're counting on an institution or a professor to teach you these things, to use their knowledge. But on the other hand, you're having to educate them on how, you know, they either don't see the full picture of an issue, or their delivery isn't equitable. You know, what works for your students of the past, or for your white students, or for your male students, et cetera, et cetera. That delivery might work for them, but you're leaving out parts of the story, or your delivery isn't effective to the rest of your class. And those are conversations that, you know, one, you wouldn't expect to have, because who prepares you for that? But then also, why should students of color have to have that?
But a lot of times I have to show up in white spaces. And when I'm talking in those spaces, as a Black student, as a Black leader, I want the people that are in the room to simply give me the benefit of the doubt that what I'm saying has no ill intent. And oftentimes, as a Black leader in these situations, that does not happen.
My number one concern is for students to be safe. We cannot be safe in this space. When the police come and they show up, they're going to take action against us, and it's not going to be a safe space.
You know, the First Amendment is one of the most valuable rights we have, just as citizens in this democracy. And I think the fight for the First Amendment actually begins here.
3, 2, 1. Apparently, I did a good job as an officer my first year. So I went to tryout to be a captain my junior year. That's kind of, it's not too rare, but a lot of the times you don't really become a captain until your senior year. So because there were so many sophomore lieutenants, my director, Ms. Fife, she decided to go ahead and choose some junior captains and then also some first lieutenants. So she chose me and another strutter, Jordan Lefebvre, to be junior captain. And that was last school year. And so, of course, this is like the big year, because everybody is like, you're a junior captain. That means you're going up for head captain next year. There's never been a Black head captain before. So that was like the whole thing. Like, it was a bigger deal last year than it is this year, now that I'm in the position. So the entire year, I have everybody in my ear like, oh my God, you're going to be the first Black head captain. It was really stressful for a lot of the time, but went through the whole process again for the third time.
And I had this conversation with Dr. Johnson. I remember coming to his office, because I would do that. I would sit in his office hours, you know, sit the whole time, like just learning history, talking about life, all these things. And I told him, you know, I was still trying to figure out what it is I wanted to do. Because I was still a business major. I knew I didn't want to do business. I told him I want to do something, right? I want to make the most of my college experience. I want to try things and really, you know, test myself. I basically gave him two options. I was like, you know, on one hand, I could run for student government, or I could go for editor-in-chief of the Star. And we sat there, we talked about what each would look like, you know, what I would do with that space. And Dr. Johnson was like, you know, I think editor of the Star would be a good fit.
I knew that student government was in bad shape. You know, I'd seen kind of the Connor Clegg incident happen, the Brooklyn Boring incidents happen, all the different things that were going on in student government. And I thought, well, I think I can make a change. And so I thought, was it the right thing to do? Would I win? And so at that point, I just decided that I could not sit back and be idle anymore. I had to take a position and run for office. And so that's how that really came about.
Ms. Fife announces who the officers are for this school year, and she announces that I'm head captain, and now I'm here.
It wasn't until I was in my first production that I, you know, kind of felt like I was editor, right? Like I couldn't believe it until, you know, the red pen was in my hands.
Winning, I wasn't very emotional because you don't believe it until you're actually sworn in and you're in the middle of things. I think that I was just proud that the student body was able to understand what our platform was, what we stood for, and was just excited and ready to get to work.
A lot of the times we get Black girls on the team and they just quit because they feel like it's going nowhere for them. So I feel like that's kind of been my main goal in this position, is to bring more Black Strutters, you know, to the team, but also for them to stay on the team. And also to bring more awareness to the Strutters that aren't Black, if that makes sense. So you'd be surprised. There's so much just ignorance, not in a bad way, but just literally like people just don't know a lot about people who don't look like them, or people who haven't had the same experiences as them, people who haven't come from the same places as them. And so this year has been a big year of just educating everybody on the team and learning more about the people around you.
There wasn't exactly a pressure from any external source, but I think I knew very well that what I had was a special real estate by virtue of being the first Black editor, and that I tried to use my platform to begin conversations, one in places that were not having them. So those are in places, you know, here within the newsroom of the Star, that's in, you know, up the hill in the School of Journalism, but then also even going higher up to upper administration for the university, of saying, hey, are you considering these ideas? Are you considering, you know, equity, access, inclusion in all of these different places, whether that's news coverage, whether that's internships, whether that's in lecture, scholarships. I had a special power by saying, hey, I'm the first Black editor. And also keep in mind, like, first Black editor in 2018, like, the school was desegregated when, 63? Or that's when desegregation at large, right, happens in 63. It took that many years.
This position is about students. And so in that way, we look at it, students come first. And so in that way, I think about what I can do to kind of change situations or make them better or help students through situations that occur on campus. And so anytime these things happen, it's the worst feeling because this is your university. Even when you're not student body president, this is your university, and you want to make sure that it's the best university. And if you have students that are being arrested, that are in tough situations, you never want to see a student arrested. You never want to see those types of things happen on campus. And so on a personal note, I think that you take a lot of that on. And so you see how to process it, how to deal with it, what's the best response. And so there's not handbooks that teach you for those things. I don't even know if it's a handbook to teach you how to be student body president. You're just kind of thrown into it and you make the best of it.
There has to be a first. So, of course, you know, in the past, it can be harder to see the future of Black students because no one has done it yet. But now that we have a first, that sets a precedent for there to be a second, a third, fourth, and a fifth. So this, seeing what we're doing now, is what gives me the hope for the future of Black Texas State.
There were things I tried that failed, and I don't worry too much about it, because that's how it goes. But I think to sum it all up, it was about creating space and giving opportunities to qualified students of color, qualified Black students.
If I did a horrible job, they wouldn't allow another one in here for a very long period of time. And so that is important to me, to make sure that I do everything I can do to make sure that I'm doing the right things and that people are accepting of Black leadership. And that's not just saying the students, but that's also referring to administrators. I mean, we have to understand that the culture here at this university is that of of a PWI mentality. And so creating these spaces for us to exist and belong is on our backs. And so I hope that that's what I've done here to create a space where anybody can come in and do well, whether you were in student government, whether you're a Black student, Brown student, or other.
Whenever a future Black girl comes onto Strutters and becomes an officer, she's going to look back like I did to see if there are any Black captains before her, any Black officers before her, and she's going to use that as inspiration for herself. So I like to think that it's legendary.
I don't know how else to describe it. Like, there's things you love, there's things you hate, there's things in the middle. That sound like a trip.
Anybody, when you're chosen to be the first at something, I think that is the honor, but I think the privilege is always the service to the student body.
And I don't even really get too personal with it, but I just got a couple things that I've really wanted to get off my chest. So if you allow me to speak to you for a second. Listen, nowadays I walk around, it's like they just don't understand me. I can give my soul to any, all this music comes in handy. Yeah, I talk about Chicago, my goals are getting paper. But I love Houston, you can catch me riding down a Rafer. Man, I came a long way from trying to fit into society. I thought I'd been myself and now the real ones admire me. I saw the beauty in this world, but now it can't inspire me. It's crazy, y'all wear glasses just so they may think to hire me. I'm young and Black as hell, that's the thing that I can't change. They expect me to be ignorant, we all